If you want to pump your body and expand your mind, there's only one place to go. Mind Pump. Mind Pump. With your hosts, Sal DiStefano, Adam Schaefer, and Justin Andrews.
Hey, you guys.
What's up, Sal?
I want you to know that I would never...
I love you, too.
...give you up, let you down, run around,
give you up, never gonna let you down.
Say goodbye, tell a lie, or hurt you.
Say goodbye, or hurt you.
Yeah! Did you guys see me Rickroll everybody on my Insta story?
Never gonna give, never gonna give.
Did you see me Rickroll on my Insta story?
Yeah.
Everybody forgets about the Rickroll.
Oh, it was beautiful.
Remember that? That was the... It was like a automated response. People were
it was
sending
a thing
an email.
For a second.
Yeah.
Also, don't forget, in this episode of Mind Pump,
hey! What?
Boom, bing, boom. For the first 38 minutes, that was a weird way to make
boom,
it.
Bing, boom.
There's a bing in there.
So bing, 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 boom, boom.
Adam talks about karaoke and the price each has paid. For Mind Pump.
Oh, Doug got that on air.
Yeah, he put that on there.
I thought that was me just bitching before.
Yeah!
No.
Who doesn't want to see that happen?
Listen, I don't want to sing as much as you don't want to sing, but I want to see Justin sing.
I don't think that's true.
Trust me.
I want to see both these things, so stop it.
That's the thing, bro. If you sing, I'll sing.
All right.
Yeah, we'll throw our panties at Justin.
Sweet.
Then Adam talks about his Camaro. That's right, ladies. He's got the 68 Super Sport Camaro that he doesn't fucking drive, but it's a hot... It's literally the car
that... Is that the only time people use bitchin'? Bitchin' Camaro.
It's bitchin'. Yeah. It's definitely... Then we talk about the homelessness in San Jose. There's a homeless person that lives in our parking lot. I'm going to try and make friends with him. What's going on there?
Give him some chips.
Adam talks about using Ned before bed. That rhymes.
Hey,
Ned is full
before you're dead.
Full spectrum hemp extract. So this is it's full of cannabinoids from the hemp plant.
The ultimate cock block.
It's got that's right, because it makes him relax and want to go to bed. We are sponsored by them. So if you go to helloned.com/mindpump, you'll get 15% off your first purchase. So if you're interested in trying cannabinoids and you want to try the legal version for most of you and you want to see how they work, go to helloned.com/mindpump. Then we talk about the Girl Scouts suing the Boy Scouts.
What? Turf wars.
What the hell's going on here? Professional sports salaries. We do a little speculation there. And then I give my input on the future of sports. This happens to be my expertise.
Wow.
Yeah, talking about sports.
Sostradamus again.
Then we get into the questions. The first question was, what would we say are the best and most important vegetables to eat? Which vegetables are the most important ones to eat? We give our opinions. And of course, we mentioned the Organifi green juice, which is a great way to supplement your vegetable intake. It's packed full of chlorella, spirulina, and adaptogens like ashwagandha.
Yeah. Wheatgrass, all that fun stuff.
It tastes actually pretty good, too. Go to Organifi.com/mindpump. Use the code mindpump for 20% off. The next question was, look, if circuit training sends the wrong signal to your body, then why do we see these CrossFit athletes that are all super buffed and muscular? What's the deal? Are you guys lying? So we talk about that a little bit, and Justin goes off on CrossFit a little bit.
I'm not even going to apologize.
It doubles down.
Yeah.
The next question was, when should you do a superset, and what type of superset is best, and for what reason? Supersets are when you combine two exercises back to back for a particular goal. We love using supersets in the third and fourth phases of our MAPS programs. We break down the science in that part of this episode. And the last question, have any of us ever gone through a period where we lost our passion and motivation for working out? And any advice on getting it back? I tell you what, if you're unmotivated right now and you hate working out, invest in a MAPS program. They are phenomenal. It's expert exercise programming. In fact,
somebody really smart made those.
This month,
it's pretty much planned out.
MAPS Anywhere is 50% off. So MAPS Anywhere is a program that teaches you how to train without equipment. All you need are resistance bands and your body. That's why it's called Anywhere. You can do it anywhere. The workouts are phenomenal and they can be very advanced. So don't fool yourself if you think you're too fit for an equipment-free workout. Try the Anywhere workouts and watch what happens. Anyway, we redid the whole program, reshot all the videos, put new blueprints in there. It looks beautiful, and it's also 50% off all month long. Here's what you got to do to get the program. Go to mapswhite.com and use the code WHITE50, W-H-I-T-E, number 50, no space, at checkout for 50% off. Go check it out.
If this is it, this is it. Please let me
know. Hey, I just want you. I just want you to know that, like, I'm the guy who does, like, is open to putting himself out there all the time. And this whole singing idea of karaoke is like a total fuck you, Adam. Put me on the spot. And I'm like, okay, cool, I'm down for that. But just know, you better step the fuck up when I'm like, hey, I want to go fucking, all of us go bowling or do a sport, and you better not 100%. Fucking.
You're talking to me?
Yes, I'm talking to you.
Mr. Slow-mo.
I'm talking to you.
Slow-mo of the mic.
Justin's done his transformation, put his fat belly out
there.
I put
my fatness out there on blast.
I got on stage and pranced around in a fucking mankini. You know what I'm saying? And
we're coming at you, Sal.
Became a mobility guy after I didn't know what the fuck anything about that.
I want Sal to learn like something.
I think we should. He should have to do
Spark
race.
Wait, hold on. You really think that I'm comfortable with singing at karaoke?
I think you're a lot more comfortable than I am.
I guarantee you I'm not.
I guarantee you
no
are.
No way. The only reason why I want to do it, first of all, is I want to see Justin in his element.
I
want to
see you guys.
Beautiful.
Yeah.
And we'll be
that's
drunk.
Beautiful.
And we'll be drunk. And it'll be, and that's why it'll be funny.
That's true.
But no, dude, I'm not comfortable getting on. I've never done anything like that in my life.
It's not about you being less more comfortable. It's the fact that it's you're putting me in the least comfortable position.
Is that really the worst thing for you?
It would be up there.
For us to go sing?
It could be up there, yeah.
Really?
I can't think of.
To.
I can't think of something. No, I'm down. Oh, okay. I'm fucking sport like that, man.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm game.
Yeah, okay. Let's do this.
Yeah. I mean, I just want to see Justin rock out, man.
Oh, yeah.
I thought that would be.
I can't wait.
Oh,
It's way too much fun.
That
like,
would
in
be
my head.
So funny.
I mean, I keep playing it out.
I mean, standing.
I think we, as far as media is concerned, let's be quite honest. We're going to get very little of you and I, Adam, that would be usable.
Like, no, I don't know.
No,
about
you know
that.
Why? There's a certain amount of like, that looks, oh my God, that's terrible and funny. And then right. After about 3-5 seconds, people will want to change. So I don't think
some people like train wrecks.
Most of it will be Justin, just being sexy,
bro. Yeah. You can try and wrap this up as much as you possibly can and try and sell it. Fucking at the end of the day, the onslaught of shit I'm gonna get is gonna be it's gonna be just as bad when I have to stand on stage half naked and people look
magnificent
judge my calves. Like it's just as bad, dude. It's putting yourself out there. That's what it is.
Oh yeah,
it is. Makes you guys feel bad. I'll put that picture out again where you're like grabbing my nipple and I'm fucking bad, you know, like super fat.
What's the sound that picture makes?
It's just very much like a.
Like, your wife will be mad at you if you do
she'll
that.
Be mad. Yeah. She hated that picture.
Yeah. Well, we all paid the price a little bit with Mind Pump.
We did. We have. We've taken our shot.
You lost a wife.
I got divorced.
I keep taking the artist.
Yeah. So let's all. Let's,
you know what?
Let's
put shit. We just. Yeah. We just lost our argument right there. Yeah.
Although that could have been a thing that helped him too. Let's be honest.
Oh, I mean, it's definitely
leveled you up.
It was definitely a good thing, of course. But
could you imagine?
But it was definitely the straw. it was the impetus that caused
the ultimate Band-Aid that hurt. Ah! Yeah.
Could you imagine having to go through that still?
Nope.
Fuck.
That would just be fucking.
It wouldn't work.
I don't want you to. No.
Although, you know, people like Craig Caperso think that it's way less worse now today than it was then. So maybe it was way harder then because of the shit that we were talking about.
Oh, we were terrible.
Right.
I mean, it would take a special person to be okay. Yeah. Anyway.
Yeah.
We don't need to talk about that anymore.
You know. What's crazy is that half the audience listening right now, more than half, has not
they haven't
heard
that.
The first 100 episodes. Yeah. The first 100 episodes have 50% less downloads than anything that we do now.
That's a little weird.
Thank God.
I mean, it's like because it's a timeline. It's like an origin of.
I'd rather
all
not.
This.
Yeah, I'd rather not like tell people about those episodes and encourage them to listen.
No, they're like really bored. They need to get caught up.
I never do.
We weren't that good. We had good chemistry and stuff, and we were fucking balls out the whole time.
We were just ridiculous.
It was a competition to see who could be the worst.
Mm. Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Shock and awe was the approach, for sure.
It was shocking.
Yeah.
And there was a lot of awe.
It'll be nostalgic. We'll go back and listen one day and be like, when was the last time you guys listened to something before episode 400 even?
That's been a long time.
Never.
Yeah.
No,
it's been a very, very long time.
Yeah, it's been a long time since I have too.
I haven't.
Every once in a while, you
just
get a new person on the forum who's like, you know, being indoctrinated with everyone, and then they go like, "Oh, I'm gonna go back and listen to ones," and I'm like, "Oh boy." Yeah, hopefully they
put
stay.
Put your seatbelt on.
Damn.
Yeah.
Have you been training more? You look like it.
I've been doing my, like, I'm probably training 3 times a week right now.
Arms are a little bigger.
It looked like you stopped and then you started again.
Yeah, I was, I kind of fell off a little bit there. What did we do? I don't know what we did where I was just not very consistent. This whole thing with Katrina too, like, it's taking a toll for me to have to, I have to do all the house stuff and take care of the boys. So a lot of times when I would be training in here, I've had to go home, and it's really tough for me once I go home
to leave and do this.
Yeah, I don't like that's yeah. that's something like I have to do my routine while I'm at the gym or go straight to the gym from here.
You gotta do the home gym, man.
I know. Yeah. I would if I didn't have the Camaro, I would. I 100% if I didn't have the Camaro, I would. That's where it would go. It'd go right there. I would definitely set up at least a squat rack.
Get the garage for it for sure.
Totally.
How often do you drive the Camaro?
Why do you got to do that?
Well, no, I'm not trying to make fun of you. I'm curious.
I know.
I'm actually curious about that.
It's like, when's the last time my hot rod truck's been running?
Right.
You know, if people ask me that.
Well, his car works, though.
I know. It is true.
I don't think yours works.
No, it doesn't.
You know, right now, not very often. It's been probably 3 weeks since I've taken it out.
Do you just start it up every once in a while?
Yeah, I always fire it up so it doesn't die or anything like that. And I typically take it around the block, at least stretch it out a little bit, and then bring it back in. It's just that lately, every time I've taken it out, there's something that I got to tweak or fix. And I'm not a fucking gearhead. So I don't get under there and figure it out myself. And I know there's a lot of guys that fucking shame me for that. You know, like, oh, you just have this amazing piece of machinery and you don't fucking learn how to work on it.
It's building value right now.
Well, that's
as we speak.
It's an investment, right? So that's how I look at it. And there will come a time.
What's it valued at now versus how much you bought it for?
I paid 40 something for it. I put another 13,000 into it. When I insured it and had it appraised at 75.
Oh, wow. So you made a nice 10, at least 15 grand, maybe 10, 15 grand over your investment.
Right. When I was shopping for a car and I wanted it was that or this like luxury car that I wanted. And I was real close to going out and buying a $100,000 Mercedes. And the reason why I didn't, and I'm not against that at all. I mean, I'm sure that's something that will be, when I have that much money that I can just kind of throw away, I think that I would drive that. But for me, I was like, okay, if I'm going to go buy a car that much or spend that much money on something, I want it to hold its value. And for the most part, almost all vehicles don't, unless it's somewhat of a classic.
Yeah,
so,
cars classically, typically are the worst place to put your money.
And it was one of the, even though I'm not seeking attention or that's not why I bought it, but I will say that, you know, I've been in Lamborghinis and Ferraris and crazy exotic cool cars, and the classic gets way more cool attention than
way more respect.
Yeah, it does. Like,
yeah,
it,
because if you drive a really expensive exotic car, you'll get people will look at you and all that stuff, but then you'll get the whole like you're pretentious or you're a douchebag. But if it's an old muscle car, everybody's going to, it's just respect.
Yeah, people appreciate it. Yep. And I really noticed that when I used to drive it down to Santana Row where like everybody brings their Bentleys and Ferraris and Lamborghinis, and it would be parked in front of like the Venetian and Hotel Valencia, excuse me. And you'd see, you know, a Bentley in front of mine and then a Lamborghini and a Ferrari parked in front of it. And people are like standing around the Camaro. I was like, oh, shit, that's cool. You know, like that's people appreciate that year of Camaros. It's just so rare to see one in that.
Yeah, they're iconic.
Yeah. And to see it in that good of condition. And every time one gets totaled, the ticker goes up on those things. So, yeah, it's something that I definitely would like. I think right now in my life, I just. It's something that I would have to learn, spend time on. I didn't have the father figure who got under the hood with me, so it would be on my shoulders to figure all that out on my own. And I believe one day I will. I think when I'm
just put on YouTube.
Yeah, when I'm in my mid.
That's funny.
Bro.
It's true.
Yeah.
I'm serious.
Yeah, I've worked on my truck with YouTube. It's awesome.
Dude. No, I believe I'll do that. I think when I'm in my 40s and mid to late 40s, I'm sure that's something that I'll totally be into. I got a lot of friends that have them and they're in car clubs and they're at different points in their life. Mm-hmm. We're in the middle of building something. This right now is my passion.
Yeah.
You know, so like if I got a free weekend, I'm putting effort and time into what we're doing right now because I have such a love for it more so than my car, my toys, my other hobbies that I love.
There's not a whole lot of room for that right now.
There's not.
Me too.
And I'm okay with that. Like I'm totally okay with it collecting dust right now, along with a lot of the other hobbies I've got the fucking crazy ATV, I've got snowboards and all the things that I love to do. And right now, there's nothing that I love more than what we're doing. It just, I mean, we're doing this now four years.
Is it going to be four?
Yeah.
This has got to be the fastest.
It was like 10.
Full business, 4 years of any business I've ever done.
Right.
And yeah.
Have you had a moment yet? I really have not had this. This is the first time in my life. All the things that I've built or been a part of, worked for, whatever, I've never done something for 4 years consecutively. And still, when I wake up in the morning, like, I can't wait to get here.
Yeah.
I really can't.
It's so weird, much right? to do.
That's a fucking very...
Wait, do you know why
that's
weird?
To me, that's more valuable than any dollar amount that we make doing this.
That's quality of life. Do you know why that's so weird? Because I've never done anything I hated. I've always done something I love.
Right.
Yeah.
So for this to be even an even higher level of that, it's very strange. Because I've been in fitness my whole life. So I've always liked what I've done.
No.
But it's never gone by this fast. I mean, 4 years... I remember how long a year took in the gym industry, running gyms. A year was like 10 years of just grueling work.
Yeah.
Yeah.
If I was in a club for a year, I was ready to get the fuck out of that club. After about a year, it was like, move me out of
right.
here.
Right.
New location.
I remember, and people ask this all the time. This is a common question I get in my DMs from like other trainers. Like, you know, do you miss training and, you know, their love for it? And it's like, you know, I love training clients. I love people. I love people. And, you know, the ability to train, you know, back-to-back-to-back clients for 8-10 hours a day, you just get this diversity of humans that you get to experience.
You get to hang out with cool people.
Right, and I love and value that. But I would be lying if I didn't say that there was mornings where the alarm went off and I'm like, fuck, I got a day today. You know, I got 10 hours of work today that I was not, or, you know, it's 8 o'clock, 9 o'clock at night and you've already seen 7-8 people and you're still there working. And I'm like, I can't. And I had those moments of wanting to get through an hour. There's never been that moment in what we're doing.
Yeah, I think that like this business brings out those best moments from, you know, training. So we are still like, my favorite part was being able to pick the brains of these brilliant people that I, you know, were my clients that were killing it in business or killing it in life or whatever decisions they're making was, you know, they're at a point where they could afford me and like, you know, we're basically handing off a lot of this knowledge to me and like strategies and all that kind of stuff. But now we bring those people on the show and we pick their brain for like 2 hours straight. And it's amazing. It's like this education. And then like every day you just get like charged and fueled, you know, by, you know, them or even just like talking. The other part is just like figuring out like the best strategies for everything.
Well,
so we get to do that.
Good conversation is like a way of thinking. It really is. So is writing. And anytime you write or you talk with other people, if you're doing it really well, it's a great way to organize your thoughts, you know, your ideas, process them. That's why talking is such an effective form of therapy. So when I can sit down and talk, even if I just talk to you guys, like when we do these episodes where we don't have a guest, you know, I may have an idea. You know how many times ideas flourish through our podcast for me personally? Like the first time I'll think something and it'll come out, it'll be on the podcast and then I'll fine tune it as we continue to discuss it. And it's accelerated that process.
Or something one of you guys said, and then it resonates later, and you keep thinking about it over and over, and then it becomes this whole path that you kind of create. It's crazy.
So you guys know you guys have seen the homeless person that now lives in our little parking lot over there?
Because you know what, bro?
The front spot.
Yeah, there's nothing wrong with that.
Because you fed him.
Yeah.
It's just like
and
a
now
cat.
He comes
it's
back.
A straight cat, dude.
Twice.
Yeah. You just can't do
it. No, I gave him more. So, no, let me tell you what happened. So in front of the parking space, this homeless person. Now, we're in downtown San Jose. It is not rare to see, I don't know, 4 or 5 homeless people every day, right? So there's a larger homeless population in San Jose. It's becoming, it's kind of a thing, you know, that's kind of growing. And most of them, the mental illness, you can tell, you know, but, you know, every time I see one, if I can, I'll give them something to eat or whatever. And there's a few regulars. Well, there was a new one that you pull into the parking lot and just crashed out sleeping in front of the parking spot.
Yeah.
And so yesterday I came in and there's a bag of like corn chips that we've had for, I don't know, a couple months. I don't know. I think it was from the Tahoe trip.
Yeah.
So I brought it out and I put the bag of chips on the ground and a bottle of water, but he was passed out. So I left, came back and still there, bag of chips still there. Today I came back and bag of chips is half, he's not there anymore, but bag of chips is mostly gone and there's a jar of salsa. So somebody must have got him some salsa for the chest.
Good call.
Yeah. So I was like, oh, cool. He got some dip for
gathering.
Yeah, he got some dip for his
random condiments.
Yeah, you know what I mean. So, yeah. But I'm trying to catch him when he's awake so I can say hi to him. You know, I'm like, hey,
talk to him.
Yeah, you know, just see what's going on.
I keep trying to. I'm like, can you like over where the grass? There's like grass, like not too far, and a little nice hill. Like I would have just picked a different spot, like instead of where you're like trying to slam the huge vehicle. I just want to shift them over there.
Most homeless people who are like homeless permanent, because a lot of people in poor, you know, who are in dire straits financially will pop in and out of quote unquote homelessness. But more often than not, they're sleeping on people's couches and stuff like that. People who actually live on the streets, a large, large percentage of them are mentally ill. They just have mental illness, so they just can't do anything other than what they're doing. And, you know, I meet them all the time out here. And there was one lady that was getting...
She'd go across the street.
She was running
slow,
through the... Yeah, cars were almost hitting her.
Oh, my God. She'd make me nervous.
Yeah,
as well.
So I ran over there and grabbed her, and she was blind. She was legally blind.
Yeah.
And she couldn't see. And I'm like, what do you do? Why are you walking in the street? And she's like, I don't know
I helped her one time.
Yeah, I walked her back over. It's okay, where are you going? I'm going on this bus. And, okay, you know, here's $5. Listen, you need to go find yourself a shelter. And, you know, but they're all this mental illness. Yeah. So it's a problem that I don't know what the solution is.
I've always wondered why we don't, like, because there's, and San Jose is not the best example of this, because I know San Jose is not, but wouldn't it be smart to like have an area where they all kind of go? Like I would like have this land, like one of the things, if you were filthy rich and you mm-hmm. had some property, just 3 acres, like 3 acres would fit a fuck ton of tents. Like why wouldn't you build an area
it would become a health hazard. You'd have to have sewer system. You have to have like... It would become a...
It would have to be managed.
Yeah, it's a much more complex, difficult problem than people realize. Here's the other thing.
It's kind of nomadic, too. They do that, you know, mm-hmm. on their own, and they'll encamp, like, certain areas, mm-hmm. and then they kind of move them along.
You see that in L.A. Like, I see in L.A., they do that, like, in like a street somewhere is just fucking... just tents everywhere.
Dude, and what they do, the police will move in, and we'll give them eviction notices, literally, and tell them you need to leave because we're going to come by here tomorrow and we're going to bulldoze this whole area. Mm-hmm. But they don't go anywhere else. They don't know what else to do, so they just move their tent somewhere else. But here's the other thing, too. There are homeless shelters that a lot of these people don't even want to go to.
No, there's a lot.
Yeah, that they don't even want
to
go to.
You say it'd be a big deal, sewage-wise, but I mean, okay, if we were trying to organize something that'd be like low, like overhead or expense, like to make this happen, well, I mean, why wouldn't lining up 10, maybe 15 fucking porta potties and on the 3 acres that I'm talking about, and then the service that you're paying for is to get those porta potties picked up once a week? Like, how would that be huge expense? I don't understand how that would be crazy.
Because drugs get used, needles get shared, people will start to get sick.
Well, that's happening no matter what, though. Right?
Well, that's the problem.
It's just about, it's like promoting it.
It is not a simple, easy solution.
No, I'm not saying
whatsoever.
It is. I've thought about these things. I'm like,
I'm not huge in government involvement, but I do think some kind of mental health would be beneficial is what I think. Because like I said, a lot of them are just mentally ill. Yeah. A lot of them are addicted to drugs. You could see it when
they're not seeking help a lot of times.
No. So it's a weird situation. It's an interesting...
Yeah, no, I've met a lot that choose
to like fuck off. You know, I've tried helping people and they like literally like are aggressive with me.
No, I've met quite a few that just literally choose to live on the street. Like they don't have no desire to get out of that. Like it's crazy.
So I remember one guy he had a sign that it said give me money so I can get a beer or a smoke. And I'm like, well, at least he's honest. Yeah. So I gave him a couple bucks. Like, here you go. I like his beer sometimes too. There you go, buddy. Yeah. Go drink. Go have a beer.
Did I ever tell you guys about my favorite bum sign that I've ever seen? It was in San Francisco at the Giants game, and the ballpark is right on the water, and they have like the walkway, like concrete walkway, but below the arena, right by where the water is at. And where Barry Bonds used to hit all his home runs over that wall. And you could, I was at a game. In fact, it was when Barry Bonds was chasing the home run record. And it was crazy to me because here we are at the Giants game. Barry Bonds is chasing the home run record. And right behind me where I'm sitting, everybody is standing up looking away from the game. And there's like a whole row of people and they're loud and they're laughing. And I'm going, what the fuck? I mean, we're in the middle of a crazy good game here. Why? And so I get up to go look. And there's a bum at the bottom, right? Below, all the way to the bottom. And he's got a big sign. And it says, I bet you can't hit me with a quarter.
Yeah.
And people are fucking chucking quarters.
About this.
And it was brilliant, dude. I mean, I must have seen $100 worth of quarters in a short amount of time being chucked at this guy by everyone's just like pulling their change out and they're throwing it. And he's dodging and he's running back. And I thought that was fucking brilliant and clever and hilarious. Eventually they stopped it, which was really shitty. You know what I'm saying? That somebody came over and had to ruin the fun.
Because
I thought, this is great. This guy's having fun doing this.
He's making money.
Yeah, he's making money. And people are chucking quarters down at him. I thought it was fucking great.
Yeah,
dude.
Well.
And then it gets all weird. Yeah, hit the butt. Yeah.
You're like, this is not. This is shitty.
So yesterday we got our shipment of Ned in. And Katrina is now boycotting Ned, because when I take all I need is two full droppers of that.
Are you doing the which strength are you doing?
So I only have the 300 milligrams. I want to try the stronger one. I haven't tried the stronger one, but I haven't really needed to use the stronger one because two full droppers of just the 300 milligrams, I take that right before we're heading up to the bed, and I let it sit under my tongue. By the time I get upstairs and we, you know, get in under the sheets and stuff like that, I mean,
just calm and out.
Dude, I pass right out.
I know.
And she's trying to get some, you know what I'm saying? Like, she's starting to feel better. And I'm just like, completely out. And so now she's like, you're not allowed to take that all the time. Either that or we got to go to bed earlier.
Those are feeding you meth.
Those cannabinoids are so good for their anxiolytic properties. People with anxiety. Yeah. That the research coming out on that is fucking mind-blowing. Anxiety is such a pain in the ass to treat, and the medications that they typically prescribe for that are addictive and terrible.
A lot of people are suffering from anxiety from like multiple different factors.
Well, so I've been reading quite a bit on this because it just seems to be exploding.
Mm-hmm.
And there's some theories that say that a lot of these anxiety issues are actually deficiencies in endocannabinoids.
Mm.
So people actually, their bodies are not producing enough of these natural cannabinoids, like anandamide, which is one of them. So they're feeling the effects of that.
Interesting.
And so that's why supplementing with cannabinoids makes them, you know, feel so much better. The real question is why are people experiencing why are they producing less of these endocannabinoids? And my hunch is that because of our lifestyle, we're just depleting the fuck out of ourselves, like we do with our other, you know, hormones and systems, because we're constantly hammering
multitude of factors, right? We're overstimulated. We don't, treat the process of like going to bed and, you know, and having sort of a ritual for that to where it's like, you know, you get to bed, it's just about how quickly you can crash, and then you don't really have that quality of sleep.
Dude, for me, so I was just doing this morning. So this is a little, it's kind of on the topic. This morning I was looking up other cannabis type companies. So obviously Ned's not cannabis, they're hemp derived, but the cannabinoids you can find in both plants. And I was reading this morning on cannabis companies that are on the stock exchange, because I know the science behind cannabinoids and what they can do. And in particular, the thing that interests me the most is their effect on cancer. Mm-hmm. I think that is, there's so much promise there, and there's no guarantees, but I think there's going to be a blockbuster out there that's going to explode. And there's all these companies that are selling for like $8 or $9 a share who are in this space.
Yeah, it's so hard to know who's going to be the.
Well, I'm trying to hedge my bets, right? Because $8, $9, you can buy 100 shares for under a grand.
Yeah. Do you see any that's big not a bad pharmaceutical bet. Companies like kind of taking that on?
Well, GW, right?
Well, GW's the biggest one, but they're all pharma companies.
Yeah.
They're all pharma companies that are coming out. There's a couple out of China that are entering into the fray now. So it's, and I know what.
Leave it to them to kick her ass.
Yeah.
Damn it.
There's a lot of them.
Yeah.
I mean, a huge population. That's why there's such a big economy, you know?
That's what's hard about when something like that hits is figuring out who's going to be the one that ends up. It's rarely ever the one that starts right away. Like, you start off, you get into it first and early, but then somebody comes in and does it better, you know?
Yeah.
It depends, because investments make a big deal when it comes to pharma.
Monsanto or Bayer.
Yeah. Oh, man. They'll probably buy one of the companies.
That's right. What I mean. That's exactly what will happen. Yeah. They'll wait. It's just like the app game. You know what I'm saying? They wait until they see someone making waves and they've got the capital, the marketing and everything behind it. They can go, oh, okay, let's go throw $100 million at this company real quick and we'll blow it up to a $2 billion company.
So you guys ready for a funny what the hell headline?
Yeah.
So this article came out today, and here's the first part of the article. The Girl Scouts of America has filed a lawsuit against the Boy Scouts.
What? Girls versus boys.
Saying that the group's gender-neutral efforts to include girls is confusing and has led to membership losses. So you know how the Boy Scouts have changed their name to the Scouts?
Yeah.
And they're trying to say we're for boys and girls. So now the Girl Scouts is suing them, saying, hey, you guys are fucking taken away from us because we're the...
Can't win,
what's
bro.
What's happening?
Can't win.
No.
You're damned if you do, you're damned if you don't. Jesus.
They're killing themselves.
Can we go back to it then? You know, like Boy Scouts? No, can't go back.
Yeah. So what if the Girl Scouts just start including boys now?
Yeah. You know what I mean? Right? Then what is it?
There's it's funny that that people made such a were so happy about the Boy Scouts now allowing girls.
Yeah.
I don't see why that's a There's definitely a lot of value in boys and girls being able to do things just with their gender, especially mm-hmm. coming of age type of stuff.
Right.
There's definitely benefits to it. So I know it wasn't politically, I guess maybe not politically correct to be just the Boy Scouts, just have boys in. And then they tried to become more politically correct.
Well, politically correct is very much against anything masculine. So
yeah.
That's just how that goes.
That's true. Because you're right. I don't see the Girl Scouts doing the same thing.
Uh-uh.
But I think this is, and when they did it, I knew it. I saw this. I was like, oh, this is not going to be good for the Boy Scouts.
It's interesting to see stuff like this change. I was just listening to the radio, the sports talk this morning. And they're talking about this is the anniversary. 2004, Ron Artest, basketball player, asked for 2 week vacation in the middle of the season and in his contract and said he wanted to, I needed to get away.
In the middle of the season?
Yeah, that was in 2004 and he got fined a fucking bajillion dollars. He got suspended for 2 weeks. This was also what led to people talking shit to him and the famous, what do they call it? The massacre or something. I forget what they call it. But this is where Ron Artest ran up into the stands. A fan threw
he hit him in the face.
Remember that.
A fan threw a soda at him, and then they ran up. Nine players ended up getting suspended, like tons of money over all of it. But that was the first time like a player had ever even asked like that. Now it's really normal. Like players take fucking time off all the time. They can demand it, and it's part of.
Oh wow!
It's part of the norm.
I didn't even know that.
Yeah, it's part of the norm now that these players can say that, like, oh, I don't want to play anymore for a couple of weeks. I mean, it's been high stress for me, and like, you know, teams now will say, okay, you know, you take some time off, or that's never was done before.
Oh, that's fascinating.
Yeah, that was in 2004, and then how much we've evolved now today, and it's just interesting to me to think that like people can get away with stuff like that. You sign a contract, you get paid millions of dollars, you work for this company, but now the company is, you know, they have to be like,
well, it's the market. If the market supports it, that's what's going to happen.
Right, right.
And these guys are so highly paid and so hard to get. I mean, how rare is it to find a person with the skills to play a professional sport?
Yeah.
And so long as the fans show up and pay for it, then I guess they can call for whatever they want.
Well, that's what's happened. I mean, the players know the pool that they have.
Yeah, they're realizing their value.
You know, and then they can negotiate stuff like that now.
Who's the highest? Who pays the most? NBA, NFL, or the
I think NBA is up there.
NBA is up there.
Really?
Well, baseball too. I mean,
don't they have a
renegotiations?
Cap or
well, they did at one point. It was like they were paying them dirt, and then they had this. You know, the strike that was like famous, and that's where I was like not interested in baseball. That they lost me completely, and then they came back with like the home run chasing, you know, that whole thing with like Mark McGwire and everybody else. And yeah, dude, it was like now everybody has like these astronomical salaries. It's insane.
The teams, a lot of teams have salary cap. They have salary caps, right, to try mm-hmm. and keep it fair. But a lot of teams will. You just get fined if you go over. So you get fined like millions of dollars.
The Yankees, like how much they always have money,
right? So a lot of teams will go over the salary cap because they know that it doesn't matter because it draws X amount more dollars to the stadium, and if they end up winning or going far,
so take the hit.
It doesn't matter.
Yeah, so they kind of take the hit. But then you have other teams like the A's that, you know, they play money ball where they play the opposite, where they run as lean as they possibly can.
They'll get rid of you at the peak.
Right, and then as a business, they run it like a little...
Fucking kills me, man.
Yeah, I know.
What do the low-end baseball players or football players or basketball players make? Like if you're in the...
Like a quarter million? So if you if you never see the player and they're sitting on the bench, they'll make like a quarter.
Oh, here's the here they are.
You might get like a signing bonus or something.
Doug's actually got the average salaries of each of the major sports leagues. Maybe start at the top, Doug, or it looks like there's five you got up there. Oh, number one is basketball. The average salary, $4.9 million. That's average.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow. Whew. Baseball.
Look at DeMarcus Cousins, who we're trying to get, right? He's on the Warriors team now. He's injured. He won't even play till January. We'll only have him playing for – and we signed for him for the $5 million, something, $5.4 million. So he's not even – the basketball players get some pretty fucking –
Baseball, $3.8 million. And then next is probably got to be NFL, right? No, ice hockey, $2.5 million for ice hockey. So they're actually averages higher than football, which is $2 million.
Wait, and the salary, that are they're talking about like their entire career, or are they talking about like year by year?
I think they're average. They're taking all the players, and they're taking all the salaries and then dividing them.
Right, yeah. So the low end will be, I believe entry low level for NFL, and you can look this up, Doug. It used to be like $250. So I think the lowest paid like – kicker or
yeah, I know, because one of my friends, he was signed on, he had a signing bonus, it was around 250 to 300,000, and then he got cut because got injured like in preseason game, and that was the end of his career, and then he invested it into remodeling houses and stuff.
The one that I would need to get paid the most to even consider would be the NFL. It's like war. Every time you play, and you're
the only thing is there's a lot more players,
and the lifespan of is much shorter. It's not like you can play football, pro football.
I agree, but yeah, it's like as an owner, you have to pay so much money for, because there's, I mean, how many players do they have to acquire? It's like 52 or 54
is a full roster for an
NFL
team.
That's a lot of paychecks.
Oh yeah, NBA you're only
and
what
coaches 13 like you get a or ton of coaches
13 or 14 in NBA.
NBA you only need like one, two coaches. You're good.
A rookie in the NFL is 480,000. So almost $500,000 a year as a rookie.
Wow, it used to be 250, so it's up to 480 now.
Yeah, that's not bad, but again, people I don't think people realize it. Like you play one game in the NFL, you're getting blasted by some of the biggest, strongest human beings on earth.
It's battle damage, dude. Practice is worse.
Well, and the scariest thing about what you see a lot of is, I forget what the stat is. It's ridiculous on how many ex-NFL players end up going on welfare. And what happens is, these young kids sign these contracts where they make $1 million or more a year. And then they get hurt 2 years later or something, and then they just no more money after that, and
they have nothing
to fall back on. And right away, the first things you go get when you're 22 years old and you make millions of dollars,
a house and a car,
all the fucking crazy stuff. Oh, 78%.
78% are either bankrupt or are under financial stress within 2 years of retirement.
Is that fucking nuts?
And an estimated 60%. You know what it is. And this is an important statistic for people to realize. I think a lot of people think money is the answer to everything. You know, making money is important, but knowing how to invest it and keep it is equally as important. It's extremely important to know these things. So these guys are going in, they're killing it, making tons of money, have zero idea what to do with the money or how to keep it.
78%, dude. That's crazy.
That's insane. Yeah,
it's almost 8 out of every 10 players.
Yep, that's insane.
There's more of a chance.
That's the vast majority.
Right.
It means you're rare. If you retire and you're still okay.
That's why when friends like Brendan, I have so much respect for these guys, and Frampton, like
he's a smart dude.
Yeah, buddies of mine that played 8 years in the league, and they've gone and made as much or more money outside of the NFL than they did.
I would think more.
Oh, Brendan for sure. He's what he just did with Orange Theory. I mean,
what you were speculating the other a while ago about how you think the future of sports is going to be virtual. I think that's 100% true. I was watching a video the other day on YouTube of these multi-directional treadmills. Have you guys seen these?
Yeah, crazy.
Where
Oculus Omni.
That's what it is. Omnidirectional. Yeah, you basically run in any direction, and it's only a matter of time before they get so good that you're going to be in this virtual reality, whatever, and you're going to be jumping and moving and diving and whatever, and it's going to act itself out.
It's going to simulate it.
And that's what we're going to watch.
Your own and it'll still,
and that's what we're going to watch.
And it'll still take super athletes.
Of course, to do all that shit.
Yeah, to do all that stuff. And it'll be just as entertaining for people if we can make it look as real and authentic as if, yeah, like you were.
But they're going to amplify.
The collisions will be simulated instead of them actually.
And they're
going
to amplify your abilities. They'll amplify your abilities. You'll be able to jump 15 feet.
Yeah.
Maybe pull. You'll touch a special star at the top of the, you know, the 30-yard line.
Now you're talking Mario Brothers.
Now you've got a freaking machine. Yeah. Who knows though? They could do it. You know, you hit someone hard enough, they explode.
Totally. That's what I think. When you see, I mean, we just got off having Andy
take some mushrooms, get fucking huge, and stomp people.
I mean, it's the only thing that, I mean, look at how we've progressed with the crazier, bigger, scarier hits as over the last like 30 years. The only thing that will allow that to continue to evolve is the fact that you somehow find a way to protect the players and still give the audience what they want, which is this crazy destruction.
Yeah, you're gonna have a power meter, you know, and every player, and your he's almost dead. Let's see how long he's gonna. Yeah. Oh no, he got the automatic life. Or
they
shit.
Killed him. Yeah. Yeah, we won't see him till next Sunday. Yeah. See you later.
I would watch that.
Of course,
I'd love that.
Yeah, no, know? I mean, and it, to me,
the owner resurrected him.
Having Andy Miller on the show and talking to him about esports and where that's going. I mean, if it's starting to get to a point where they're filling up stadiums and you're watching.
Yeah, they got to figure out the physical side of it because we need that to have like keep you in reality, but at the same time exaggerate it, right? Which I think that'll be, once they figure that out,
I think you're right. Yeah, I think you're right, because gaming with just traditional gaming with the controllers.
That shit looked really boring to me. I'm sorry.
It gets confusing. Now, and they're, you know, to argue on their side, these kids growing
they're
up,
into it.
Yeah, they grew up with it. So it's not like us where we didn't necessarily grow up with all that shit. Like my son can look at a screen, shit's moving in all directions, and he's fine. I watch it.
He knows what's going on.
Yeah, I watch it for 15 seconds. I get dizzy.
Dude, I saw that too. It was on, I think it was on one of the ESPNs, and they were like actually showing an Overwatch tournament, and I was like, oh wow. So they are getting some airtime now with this as well. Mm-hmm. So very interesting.
But if they did it where the players had to physically do the stuff, like jump and dive and, you know, whatever, then there would be limitations based on the physical attributes of the person. And now you bring the classical sport element back into.
Right. That
and I think they can do it.
I think so too. I think there'll still be value to somebody who has to
wear
train and be. I mean, you could still, all those things will still be important.
So what do you think the best players would look like at that point? They wouldn't be the biggest, strongest people.
No, they wouldn't.
They'd be probably the most agile.
Yeah, reactive and quick and fast. Yeah,
now, I'm picturing these facilities like a warehouse where it's like all green screen all around them, and then they have like those like sensor suits on, you know, and then they just like have their own designated section. They do all their physical shit, and then we look at it on a screen as this crazy world, you know.
I think it would be super rad. You'd have all these, like, all the guys would be like 5'9" gymnasts, you know what I mean?
It would be all the Cirque du Soleil people would come in and just mop up.
They could do all, it would be like, it's like that movie that came out, what was it called,
Player One.
And I'd watch that shit. I would totally watch that shit. I'd love to see players explode.
Oh yeah,
that'd be on sick. Impact.
Fatality.
Yeah. Whoa.
Yeah. You know? Oh shit.
This quaz brought to you by Organifi. For those days you fall short on getting your organic veggies or whole food nutrition, Organifi fills the gap with laboratory-tested, certified organic superfoods to help give your health and performance the added edge. Try Organifi totally risk-free for 60 days by going to Organifi.com. That's Organifi.com. And use the coupon code MINDPUMP for 20% off at checkout.
First question is from the Maple Leaf Man. What would you guys say are the best and most important vegetables to eat?
Kale, spinach.
Yeah. Right? Yeah. Like, I mean, so you have seasons, right, for all these different types of vegetables. That's got to play a factor into it, right?
Well, what are the most nutrient? I think kale and spinach are two of the most nruciferous, right?
Those are pretty nutrient. The cruciferous vegetables have some special qualities. For example, broccoli contains something called indole 3 carbonyl is the name of it, and it acts as an anti-cancer agent in the body, in studies showing it reduces the risk of things like breast cancer and stuff like that. You know, here's the thing about vegetables. Pretty much every study that's ever been done on nutrition has shown that vegetable consumption is associated with better health and longer life. But there's a lot of misconceptions out there with vegetables. Like one of the misconceptions is that eating vegetables raw is the best way to consume them. Mm-hmm. That one I like to talk about a lot because people really believe that to be true.
Well, also, too, I mean, pesticides have to play a factor to that, too. If, like, you're eating ones that are, like, more prone to having more of a higher concentrate of pesticides, like, obviously, the more organic you can go with that, yeah, the better. But all the more important, there's certain vegetables that will get probably sprayed the most with that. So
yeah, I go organic, and I also like to cook my vegetables. Now, yes, when you cook vegetables or when you boil them or whatever, you do lose some of the nutrients. However, you're able to capture more of the nutrients that are left in the vegetable because they're easier to digest. You know, you know how many times I've had clients tell me, oh, if I eat a cup of broccoli, like I get gassy or whatever. And I tell them, just cook them really well and see how you feel. Mm-hmm. The cooking process helps to break down some of those fibers so that they're easier to digest. And as a result of that, you're able to eat much more. You guys have seen the bowls of vegetables that I'll eat.
Well, I didn't. Yeah. You're the one that really, I never even thought to try and do that. But I also come from the era of, you know, demonizing fat and butter. Like, I would never use butter on anything back in the days, you know? And so vegetables, if I did have them, they were very bland and dry. And it was you who, when we first started the show, you would show up with these massive bowls of broccolini and rapini
vegetables,
and but
it's all the sulfur ones too, right?
But man, you put a little bit of butter or balsamic or olive oil, man, and it really, it makes vegetables actually really good for, and I've now, that's kind of all, there's sometimes I'll eat a vegetable dominant meal with just a little bit of meat or something else to go with it, and I can do that now. I never did that before, and I also have like a rule for me where, because very easily I can go, you know, a couple days and not have greens or not have a couple meals where I really don't get very many. So if I have less than two servings in the day of vegetables, I almost always do my Organifi green juice. Mm-hmm. If my goal always is to get all of my meals, get a healthy portion, a big size bowl there. But if my emergency, and that's why I love the Organifi green juice, is I keep that on call all the time. I have the Katrina keeps the packets in her purse and with her, so if we're out restaurants and I don't have any greens, or if we're traveling or something, we use that, and then we always have one in the refrigerator at home. And if I can't get to the two, then I use that. Otherwise, I'm always trying to get at least 3 to 5 servings of veggies in the
day. One of my favorite vegetables of all time that is not common, it's hard to find in stores, but luckily the Whole Foods over here and the one by my house will, not always, but typically will have it, is broccoli rabe, R-A-B-E, it's
rabe.
Called. And they look like, it's almost like they look like spinach with a little bit of broccoli. Like, they're very leafy. They have little tiny,
it's like skinnier trees.
No, they're very leafy.
No, that's broccolini.
No, you're thinking broccolini. Broccolini.
Yeah, I thought rapini was the,
it's the same, rapini or rabe.
Oh, okay, I was going to say rapini.
In Italian, you call it rapini.
Got it.
And it's the big leafy green, the big leaves, and then they have the little, what look like cruciferous, you know, broccoli, but they're real, real just small.
Little nuggets.
Yeah, they're really, really small. And so what I do with those is I cut off a lot of the stem just because it's tough, and you can eat that too, that's fine, but I'll typically cut it off, and then I'll boil them, and I'll boil the fuck out of them. Yeah. Get them real nice and soft, drain the water, I put them on a plate, olive oil and salt, and it is the best, hands down, best food I've ever eaten for my gut. By hands down. And if I give it to anybody, if I have a friend or family member who's complaining of gut issues, especially constipation, I'll tell them, make this, cook it really, really well, because you're going to consume a full bushel of it. Mm-hmm. Add a little olive oil and watch what happens. And sure enough, so easy. It's just, you eat it and it's so smooth. And you go to the bathroom and you feel great. And it's just feels amazing. It's my favorite vegetable.
What was the doctor that we had on? And she was talking about the sulfur being like she was like emphasizing the vegetables with sulfur over all of them.
Was it Dr. Walls?
Yes, Dr. Terry Walls.
Yeah, it might
yes.
have been her.
Yeah, and like between you eating like those huge bowls, and then she kept reiterating how important like the amount, the like the actual serving size like you'd get per day was like way outside of what I was eating, and just like stressing the importance of that. I've been kind of changing my approach to vegetables as a result of that.
Yeah, one vegetable that's made a comeback in recent years is Brussels sprouts, which I think is hilarious.
I fucking love those. It's why was that one of them that everybody's like, ew, well, you it's know like why? My favorite.
Because if you had it how I had it when I was younger, which was just fucking steamed, they're nasty. I think just steamed Brussels sprouts are nasty.
Just cabbage. They have like a, little cabbages.
Well, they have a bitter aftertaste to them. Mm. But man, if you make those right,
like
you,
the way Doug does.
Oh yeah,
Doug's Brussels sprouts are just ridiculous.
Yeah, yeah, they're drowned in bacon fat. And,
well, yeah. That's okay.
No, I know
it's sautéed with yeah. It's, oh, dude, little bacon bits.
We've taken Doug's recipe and Katrina and I have made all kinds of different variations from that recipe, and that's how we eat Brussels sprouts all the time. You know, something else is that's a very easy tip for people that has helped me, and it's a tip that I used to give to clients is eat them first. You know, when you sit down, when you sit down at a table, we've been trained. You know, the American diet is very common to get served tortilla chips or bread, or you know, you eat all these carbs and or processed type foods first, and then you move into your juicy meat or whatever that you get, and then whatever you have room for, we tend to have our greens, and you know, you tend to leave some of those on the plate where. Now I always eat in reverse. I'll finish all of my greens and
I prioritize my food the same way I'll prioritize my training. So if I'm in the gym and my priority for the day is my squats or my deadlifts or my chest or whatever, that's typically the first thing that I'll work. I think you should do that with nutrition too.
I agree.
When you have your food in front of you, you know, okay, I'm trying to bulk right now, so I need calories. Okay, that's okay then. Make sure you eat your proteins and your fats first or whatever. But if you're trying to prioritize health, and especially if you're trying to cut, eat a big serving of vegetables first. Well, it'll help you eat less. You're going to get all those wonderful nutrients. You're going to get the low calories.
What I love about that attitude, too, and this is what I teach, is like, because people ask, well, can I ever have bread or can I ever do this or I love this? Listen, don't play this game with yourself of what you can or can't have. It's starting off on the wrong foot with nutrition. It's like, feed your body what it needs first, like you're saying, prioritize it that way. You know what's neat is like I don't tell when I sit down at a restaurant and we're eating, I don't say I can't have the roll. If I eat my big serving of veggies, I eat my meat and whatever, you know, potato or what else I have on there. And then if I still have room and I want to have a piece of bread, I'll have it. But what ends up happening most of the time is I'm fine. Mm-hmm. You know, by the time I get through all those other prioritize all the things that are much higher in nutrient value for my body. A lot of times I don't feel, or I'll have a little bit of it instead of having where, you know, those rolls come out on a table at a restaurant. I mean, fuck, I'll crush four or five of those things, or they come out with their half loaf wherever you're at. You know, I'll sit there and get, you know, 500 calories of that before I even eat my main meal. And so instead of doing that, I'll eat.
And that strategy works really well for kids too. This is something that Jessica really implemented with our family, with the kids. And it was hard for me at first to get on board because it was so different. But now it's brilliant. Like my kids, when we sit down to eat, the first thing on their plate is their vegetables. And in order for them to get to the next stage, they have to finish their vegetables. And it's not a question. Oh. This is just how we eat. And it works. They eat way more vegetables now than they would have done before.
You know, it's crazy. Like, and you were able to make that transition later with your kids. But, you know, I think about parenting now, and if you have a kid that's, you know, 2 years old or younger, if you just start that as a habit with the family, the kid won't know any better than that. Yeah. You know, it's where I feel for parents that have kids that are 10, 12, 13 years old right now, and then they're trying to implement that. I know that would be really, really
tough. It's going
to
take months.
It's tough.
Right. But
it takes tough undoing.
Right. But if you could start off that way, the kids won't know any different. It's just that's how, if mom and dad eat that way and you've just kind of always done that.
Look, it's
such a good habit.
It becomes ingrained in you. The reason why it was so hard for me to break was I grew up eating a particular way, and the way I would eat was pasta first, meats next, then we're going to have our salad typically, then we're going to have fruit and nuts, and this is just the way my culture eats their food. So when, for example, my parents eat over, and we serve food, vegetables first, and then my parents are like confused. Where's the pasta? Well, we eat that at the very end. Well, why would you? That's not when you're supposed to eat the pasta. We're supposed to eat it in the beginning. So it's this funny thing. But no, you know, I wanted to ask you, Justin, because you went for like 5 or 6 weeks without touching a single vegetable.
I know, huh?
What are the differences you noticed when you ate, when you reintroduced them versus when you didn't have them? Because you did carnivore there for a little while.
Yeah. At first, it was a little bit of an adjustment. So my stomach... obviously, like there's like certain components like gas and like just like certain things that I had to kind of fight through, like with just bringing fiber into to my body again. Like, I think just having that was a bit of, you know, a few days of just like kind of dealing with the reintroduction of it. But once I got, you know, through that initial bit where I was just slowly reintroducing, you know, vegetables, and I actually did it more with the green juice. And I was just, I was doing that because it was already, it was less like,
it's already easy to digest.
It's easier to digest. Thank you. Yeah. That's what I was looking for. Yeah. And so that helped me sort of to ease back in transition. But once I started eating like broccoli and I started eating, you know, kale and like a little more fibrous, like intense, you know, sulfurous like type of vegetables, that was like a challenge. But now I oh my God, I went completely on the other side to where my body was like, oh my God, where's these been? Like it felt like now my body recognized how, you know, depleted and deficient I was, to where I crave it. And I saw Brussels sprouts like the other day, and I've just been on this tear of just eating Brussels sprouts lately.
How do you eat yours?
I eat mine like sauteed, like in kind of the way that Doug like, you know, showed us with ghee, and so we'll do that with some of the little prosciutto.
Oh,
yeah, like it's just good. I mean, they're just so goddamn tasty.
The other things too, a lot of people don't consider vegetables, are the algaes and the sea vegetables.
I was going to ask you about that. I've seen like spirulina is one of them, and chlorella.
Yeah, those are both extremely nutrient dense algaes that you get in the ocean.
Mm-hmm.
And now if you were to eat them raw, they'd be hard to digest because the cell wall is so hard and so dense. But what companies do, like Organifi, is they break it down for you, pre-digested, then you drink it as a powder and you get all those nutrients. But those are extremely nutrient-dense. Spirulina is very high in protein, very high in nutrients. Same thing with chlorella. And then seaweed. Seaweed is a great source of iodine. And there are a lot of people now, not everybody, but there are a lot of people that have iodine deficiencies, especially this is something you want to take a look at.
Isn't it a lot in kale too?
This is something you want to look at if you don't use iodized salt. So if you use sea salt and Himalayan pink salt, you can actually test to see what your iodine levels look like. Because if your iodine levels are off, it's going to affect your thyroid production. And that'll affect your energy, your well-being, how you burn body fat, all that stuff. So figure that out. And then if it is low in iodine, eat some seaweed. And it's a great source of natural iodine. So,
next question is from Saris Alexander 123. If circuit training sends the wrong signal, for example, cardio with weights, why do non-professional CrossFit athletes have very muscular bodies?
Oh, good question, Sal.
Yeah.
Did you hear this?
Yeah, I did.
Oh, I just love to tackle this. You know what's funny is it's if anybody were to do cleans, squats, deadlifts, overhead presses at the volume that CrossFitters do that on a weekly basis, you're all going to build an, regardless if you do it in a fucking cardio fashion or not, you're going to build build a muscular physique. Now now where I would challenge is if you take those exact same bodies that you're envisioning right now and they did way less cardio intense or trained the same amount of volume with more rest and better programming, they would be even more muscular.
And is this also athletes that came over into CrossFit that you're seeing? So like sort of the democratization of sport, while you're seeing like certain people gravitating towards like certain activities in general, because my perspective is not the case. Like I see a lot more CrossFitters that have gone through it, had decent results, and then have completely fallen off.
Listen, for every CrossFit athlete that's not professional, but CrossFit athlete that is ripped, it looks muscular, I'll show you 50 CrossFit members that don't look like they even work out. Now, this is not
what you see in like all gyms.
This is not a knock on people, okay? But this is the problem with this is, first off, the few that do get ripped on the insane type of exercise programming that not all, but some of these CrossFit boxes have, it kind of selects the genetic anomalies that can actually recover and repair and build. Most people going through CrossFit eventually stop or have to stop because it's too much. It's too much working out. It's too hard. Maybe injury, overuse injury, the intensity. It's group training, which makes it more difficult. Now, here's the deal. And I'm seeing this more and more today than I ever did, you know, even 3 or 4 years ago. more and more CrossFit boxes are being run by good coaches who understand this and who are training people much more appropriately. But early on,
a valid point. Yeah.
Yeah, early on, it wasn't like that. Early on, you go to a CrossFit, but they beat the crap out of you. It was like, we're fucking going balls out. It's going to be crazy. And so I would get lots of people who would come to me afterwards with injuries or burnout. It was very common for someone to come to me and you know, want to hire me, and I'd ask them their exercise history, and they'd be like, well, I did CrossFit for about a year. I burned myself out, and I stopped working out for, you know, for a year. Now I want to hire you.
Not only that, but also this, you know, perception of a body being more muscular a lot of times is because they're leaner.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I remember people thinking that I was the biggest I'd ever been when I was walking around at 3-4% body fat, and by no means was it the biggest I've been. I was 30-40 pounds bigger than that before, but people thought I was bigger because I was more muscular and more defined. And so if you're doing something that is high calorie burn and you're lean and you have a leaner body, you're going to look more muscular also. So take that. And that was my point of saying that those same bodies that you're looking at, if I got a hold of them, I could make them look much more muscular. Mm-hmm. If I rested them more, fed them more, and you can make them look bigger and more muscular than they already are. And like what Sal was saying, there's definitely this genetic component that's being involved, that these people are able to handle this super high intensity
lifting weights was purely relegated to bodybuilding and physique competition and figure and bikini competition, okay, if it was like an umbrella like CrossFit, where the only way you'd lift weights is if you went and joined these, you know, weights clubs, and everybody, and then they compete in stage presentation sports, your perception of people who lifted weights would be, oh man, everybody that follows this program looks like a bodybuilder or a physique competitor or a bikini competitor. That's not true. Some people do, but most people that lift weights look like everyday regular people. Why? Because you need good programming, you need good nutrition. It's not just the fact that, it's the same thing. It's the same thing with CrossFit. This is the same exact thing. The people that tend to stand out, and then you say, wow, you look really ripped. What do? I do CrossFit. Oh, everybody that does CrossFit looks like that. No, not at all.
Yeah.
Like I said, for every one, that I'll show you 50
right.
that don't. I've been to at least a dozen.
Well, CrossFit. Fuck. We work next to one.
Yeah,
and we work next to one, and we see 30 CrossFit bodies a day.
Yeah, yeah. And it's just they're regular people, yeah. working out, and it's still rare to see the really fit, you know, ripped person. Just like it's rare to see them, you know, anywhere else.
And Instagram is a very bad example.
Terrible example.
Yeah. You know what I'm saying?
Instagram will have you believing everybody looks like a cartoon character.
Yeah, and the ones that last, like, maybe they will be the specimens. Like you said, like, it's, you know, if you see like certain people that stay for like the long period, they can genetically handle a lot of the stress.
I feel like they're trying to, because isn't Glassman kind of moving away from the games a little bit?
Yeah, I feel like his efforts are more towards like addressing
the boxes.
Yeah, or even just like the soda companies, and he was like on this major push to kind of like go against like Coca-Cola and all these things.
Who knows what the fuck they're doing?
I hope this is the approach. This is what we talked about, like episode 4 or something like that.
Yeah,
where
I don't even care anymore.
Yeah, I know, I don't care. It's irrelevant.
Well, it's a sport.
CrossFit is becoming irrelevant.
Well, the boxes
finally
boxes need to treat it like a workout. Out for people rather than treating it like a sport, which when you train like for a sport, it's always high performance all the time.
It was a great fad. You had your time. Right. You know what I mean? Let's fucking stop talking about it. Just move on.
Stop.
It's lame. I'm going to keep reiterating this because I want it to die.
Oh my God.
It'll never die. It's become a great sport, right? It's what we said since the very beginning. Yeah.
I think it's starting.
Oh yeah. No.
Let's go back to real sports.
We've definitely seen the peak of it. And I think that it's not only is it leveled off, but we're seeing the other people coming back the other direction. Any sort of growth I think they're seeing right now is overseas more so than it is in the United States. I think as far as the United States is concerned, I think it's pretty flat or even going the other direction. So, I mean, it is. Since day one, we've talked about it. I've got so much respect for the positive things that it's done in the health and fitness community.
No doubt.
I've never seen so many deadlifts and overhead presses. And
they by themselves completely changed the culture, which I appreciate.
I got a lot of love, a lot of respect for that. And I think that we've said that enough times. But at the same time, too, it's very sport specific. It's, you know, it's lifting weights as a sport. It's not the best way. It's not even close to the best way to be healthy and in shape. I'm sorry. It just, it is not. It's not individualized enough. Anything that's, and honestly, anything that's taught in a class, anything that's taught in a group of 20 to 30 to 50 people. And it's the same, it's the same knock that I had on Orange Theory was, you know, cool. It's a great group environment. Yes, it probably makes people a little more consistent because they have this community that they have that they've created around it, and they've made fun with the colors and all this stuff like that. But at the end of the day, what ends up happening is at one point, a lot of these people end up getting injured and set back, or they fuck their metabolisms up so much because they push so hard and they don't fuel and rest properly. And then what happens is they have these crazy swings of they're either on the wagon or off the wagon. And when they're off, they're fucking way deconditioned. They're way out of shape.
God, I've seen so many people, women in particular, and maybe mainly because of the female body is a little more sensitive to this, but I've had people come to me and hire me who were 20 to 30 pounds overweight, who were doing 3 or 4 CrossFit workouts a week, working out like crazy, trying to watch their diet, and can't figure out why they can't lose weight. Now they have good stamina and stuff. You watch them work out, they can sweat and push their body. But they'd come to me and they'd be like, why am I not like losing weight? What's going on? Is this just my body? I'm like, your body's holding on to that. We need to completely change how you're training. And it's going to take us, you know, maybe 6 months to reverse what's happened. And I mean, it sucks when I say that. Well, the look on their face is like,
oh. Well, what ends up happening, and it's just like what I'd see at Orange Theory, is the people that are most attracted to this way of working out are the worst ones to do it. That's the problem. The problem is, if you really like that, there's a reason why you really like it. It feeds right into your personality. That's a very dangerous thing for the, and before CrossFit existed, I mean, we pick on CrossFit, but, you know, 15 years ago when I was coaching, like, nobody knew what the fuck CrossFit was even around yet. And the issues that I would have is I would get a type A personality, and instead of CrossFit, they circuit trained with weights and they did cardio hardcore, yeah, and they were high stress jobs, type A personalities. Yeah. They were eating fucking 1300 calories, and they come to me and they hire me and they're like, help me out. Like, and then how they want me to train them? They want me to crush them in the gym.
They would actually say that.
Yes. Yeah. I push hard. I do this. I do that.
I want a really hard workout. I want you to really push me. It's like, you don't want a trainer. You want a fucking motivator.
Drill sergeant. Drill sergeant.
I mean, all this good stuff, but they've also pissed like directly in, you know, the well for people that like want to actually train to get better at something. Do you know what I'm saying?
Like, no, explain what you mean by that.
Okay. So what I'm saying is, in terms of like playing a sport, they've also like, They've convoluted that whole process of like me working out to better myself to then see how that translates into my performance.
Yeah.
That became the sport.
Yeah.
Which fucked everything up.
Yeah.
So, you know, I know I'm gonna get some heat for that, and I'm okay with it. Like, I really am. At this point, like, people need to just get over it and like, let's do something else.
Next question is from Tara Sings. When should you do a superset, and what type of superset is best and for what reason?
Oh, more good questions there.
I love superset. Now, technically, you can superset whenever the hell you want. You can even superset during a strength phase. I've actually done supersets where I'm doing very, very low reps, and the way I'll do a superset is I'll do an explosive movement first just to prime my CNS, and then I'll go into the slow, grinding, heavy movement. So technically, you can do them anytime. Now, that being said, I think supersets are best used when you're trying to maximize a pump. If your goal in your workout is to try and get the most intense skin-splitting pump.
I only train them in our phase 3 of our programs.
Yeah, that's the only place we put them.
Yeah.
Is in our third and fourth phases of our programs where that's the goal. The goal is that what's called sarcoplasmic hypertrophy. So sarcoplasm, for people who don't know, represents all the non-muscle fiber structures within your muscle, which actually makes up a majority of your muscle. This includes water, glycogen, you know, capillaries, other structures that are not muscle fibers. And you can actually increase the amount of these. You do it temporarily every time you get a pump. When you get a pump, it's called transient sarcoplasmic hypertrophy. It's getting bigger temporarily. You can increase and improve your muscle's ability to do this, and perhaps have some long-lasting size effects by training this. And the pump itself has been tied to hypertrophy anyway. Just getting a pump itself has been tied to building more muscle. So that's one I loved using supersets for. But there's three different ways that I typically will incorporate a superset. There's three of my favorite ways of doing a superset. One is a pre-exhaust superset. So pre-exhaust superset is when I'll do an isolation movement first, and then I'll do a compound movement next.
So like a chest fly, you know, with dumbbells, and then go over to a barbell bench press.
Right, and it's for the same body part. So the goal is to do an isolation movement for a major muscle group and then move to a compound movement. So you're pre-exhausting, so like my quads. Let's say I want to hit my quads really hard. I could do leg extensions or sissy squats, which is more of an isolation movement. Really fatigue my quads, then go into barbell squats. Now I can call upon my hamstrings and my glutes and everything else to help me, but my quads are pretty fatigued from the first movement, and the pump I get is just absolutely insane. So that's one way to do a superset. The other way to do a superset that I really enjoy is like an antagonistic superset. And this is where, and this, believe it or not, is how I most often superset, and I typically will do this in my arm workouts regardless of what phase I'm in. And this is where you hit one muscle and then you hit the opposing muscle right afterwards without any rest.
That's technically a compound set. We've talked about this before.
Yeah, but yeah. You can still call it a superset, right? Yeah. Superset, well, the old definition that Weider, he's the one that invented this term, I believe, was two exercises with no rest was his definition. Although a compound set would mean the same thing, mm-hmm. two things. So the kind that I'm talking about would be like a bench press to a barbell row would be a good example, chest and back. Or the way I like to do it, curls to an overhead tricep extension, so bicep and tricep. And I really like the way this feels. One of my best feeling super. It's nice to have both sides of a body part feel pumped and engorged. It's,
you know, my advice to somebody is to, you know, evaluate your own training. And this is a tool, again, like many things that we talk about in your, you know, training, your training tool belt. And it should be used that way to where you're not doing it all the time. Now, I was notorious for doing this all the time. And I noticed a significant difference when I actually started to phase this and do it like we do now, where I only run it for 3 to 4 weeks. I incorporate them into my training regimen and then I'm out of it. And then I come back about
way more effective.
And I've noticed it. Now, the biggest thing that I noticed, and so if you're listening and this could be you, like I loved supersetting. I used to almost superset everything that I did in all my workouts, is what I would notice is when I was pumped in the gym, I would grow. I feel like I looked amazing. I got really good at being able to get these massive pumps. But then I felt like I would deflate when I left the gym. And then I felt like, man, sometimes I look like I don't even really work out that much. This sucks, but I look great when I'm all pumped up. If I could only just look the way I looked when and when I think about it now, like understanding the science behind it, you know, it's exactly what you said, Sal, is I got really good at the ability to maximize the pump and to be able to fill all that fluid in those muscle bellies and look really pronounced and large. But then my actual muscle fibers hadn't grown and gotten that much bigger from it. And when I started to really strength train and drop into those, you know, singles, doubles, triples, and five repetition type of training with rest periods, and I started to, and this is, we talk about this, like, what is that? And we call this like dense or grainy type of look. Mm-hmm. And now I don't have to be as pumped up, and I can see my muscle definition more than I ever have in my life. And that to me was because I abused this technique, mm-hmm. and I was drawn to the pump and the superset. So, you know, and then the reverse is true. If you're somebody who loves the strength training and you love the 3-minute rest periods and you never chase after the pump and you never superset.
Oh yeah, watch what happens.
This will be an incredible tool for you to incorporate in your training. So you just have to really evaluate, are you somebody who loves doing this so much because you love chasing the pump and you probably overuse it and abuse it? You need to probably cycle out of it and allow yourself not to train that way for a few weeks. And if you're the other side, we always tend to gravitate to one's the other. So think of it like
something I'm always trying to implement because I won't do it.
Right, you're the opposite.
Yeah, but I love the effects that it brings once I start to kind of train that way and you get that different stimulus. And it's really important to schedule that. Otherwise, yeah, I will fall directly back into my old patterns and then you're just going to stay the same.
Man, and for sports, you know, supersets, and they don't call them supersets in sports. I think, what do they call them? Like complexes and
yeah,
in clusters or whatever. And for sports, you can do these great, these are great for performance. They're great to build strength and endurance. So like a good example of a superset that I would do with an athlete would be to like drive the sled and then do some squats, or vice versa. Do some squats and then drive the sled, or do some heavy deadlifts and then throw a medicine ball up as high as you can.
Box jumps into squats.
They're great for performance. God, back in the day, man, when I was, you get away with so much when you're in your 20s. I swear to God, your body's indestructible. Some of the workouts that we would do with supersets were just silly. Yeah. They were just absolutely, I would do these, because the third type of superset, which you could technically call it a superset, but it's really called a strip set.
Or a drop set,
Or a drop set is where you go from, you know, you do as many as you can with one weight and then you drop to a lighter weight.
Remember doing that with a leg press?
I haven't done that in a long time.
Remember doing
that
with a leg press when you were a kid? You'd stack up 10 plates on each side.
Go all the way down to nothing.
All the way down to nothing.
Oh my God. That was horrible.
We would
love doing that with the bench press, though. Oh, that was great.
Or just curls. Go to the gym, grab your heaviest dumbbells you could do five reps with, and then I'd go old, you know, so I'd start with like 50-pound dumbbells, and I'd go all the way down the rack until I got down to 5-pound dumbbells.
I haven't done that in so long.
Oh, yeah. And it's
I'm
just
gonna do that today. I haven't done that in so long.
And see, this is the thing that makes you feel like I want to fucking. And right, I get excited talking about it.
It's the thing is this, like, this would be a great time for me to do that. I haven't done that in years. Like, what a great stimulus for my body. The problem is, you know, back when I used to do it, I used to do it all the time. You know, it used to be like a thing that I did all. And I think that that's the takeaway for people when you talk about supersets, drop sets, compound sets, any of these, you know, training to failure, like a lot of things that we talk about. There's lots of benefits to all those things when you intermittently put them into your routine. You just got to be careful. What happens is when you intermittently put them in your routine and then you see a response, you're like, whoa, I feel stronger. I look better. Then what do? We fall in love with it. And then we continue to do it all the time into our routine. The body adapts to it. And then the results that you were getting, like you got from the beginning when you were intermittently doing it, begin to diminish. So being aware enough to know, okay, am I doing this a lot? And typically anything that you do beyond 3 to 4 weeks when strength training, the body tends to get pretty adapted. Now, there's going to be individual variants. Some people can get away with it for 5 or 6 weeks. Some people can probably only do it for 2 or 3 weeks and they started to see it diminish. But that's why we phased all the MAPS programs in that range of the 3 to 4 week range, is that's kind of the sweet spot we found with clients is, you know, transitioning out of using that technique. So if you're training to failure, you're drop setting, you're supersetting, you're doing any of these things, you know, don't really allow yourself to do it much longer than about 3 or 4 weeks before you kind of phase out of that.
It's definitely not the staple. Shouldn't be the staple.
Right.
Next question is from Hecka Stubborn. Have you ever gone through a period where you lost your passion or motivation for working out? Any advice for how to get it back?
Yes. This has happened to me a lot. And what has got me back into it is changing my focus. So a lot of times, you know, I'll have a goal in mind that is important to me for whatever reason at that time, and then I'll either want to achieve that goal or I'll just get tired of just chasing that all the time, and then it results in me not caring anymore. So I love to challenge my body in different ways. One of the things recently that you've heard on the podcast, if you've been listening for a long time, I really took the mobility thing to like a whole nother level for me, because I had never set a goal like that. It had never been a major goal. Like, you know, how mobile can I take my immobile ass and see, and instead of like measuring my aesthetics, you know, because right before that, my main goal was like, how amazing can I make my body look and get on stage and present it and win plastic trophies. And that was fun while it lasted, but I couldn't, like, if you look at me now, I don't look anything like I look like when I got on stage. And I don't care, because it's not my goal. I've had other goals. And so I love to set new goals that are completely different. I think we tend to get so caught up in this, either the scale or how we look. And that's normally the driver for almost everybody who goes to the gym. But set different types of goals, you know?
Yeah, it's the perfect time, I feel, for me to learn something new, like in terms of
a skill.
Yeah, like mace bell, or this is what got me into a lot of this unconventional style training, just because moving my body in a different way, and also trying to just learn all the little nuanced things that are involved with unconventional training. And I know that that's probably a deterrent for some people, because they just want it to be super straightforward. I just want dumbbells. I just want a barbell. It's nice and, you know, balanced. But like, I like to challenge my body in new ways, try new types of moves where I have to twist, a turn, and really challenge my body. And so I could get fixated on something like that real easily. But I go through these, I go through periods like this all the time where I'm like, you know, I'm bored. I'm bored training. What am I going to do next? And so that's, you know, if you could find something like an event or something to kind of stimulate, you know, that back.
Even like a single move. So I had this discussion with Taylor and Enzo just a couple weeks ago. And, you know, I love talking to Taylor because Taylor does not have a passion for lifting weights. The guy keeps his diet in check. He's got abs. He stays lean. He can fit in his skinny jeans. He don't give a fuck about building a bunch of muscle. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Like, he doesn't care. Like, it's not as long as he's healthy, he wants to be healthy, and he is healthy. And so for him, he says, like, man, it's so, Adam, sometimes I don't feel like going to the gym and do that. I was like, don't treat going to the gym always like you have to follow, like, our MAPS program. Like, sometimes, Taylor, if you want, like, I taught him a Turkish get up.
Right.
And they'd never done it before.
Yeah.
And I'm like, dude, go to the gym.
He's trying to look at it. I'm like, it's getting better.
Right.
Yeah.
So I go, you know what? When you come and you have those days, like, just do a whole hour of perfecting your Turkish get up and get it. And he's like, I could do that? I'm like, of course you could do that. And there's so much great carryover from a movement like that incorporates your entire body. And it actually is, it's very mentally stimulating for people that seek novelty, like most of us do, most of us humans do. So instead of always having to chase this aesthetic goal or this weight loss goal or weight gain goal or the way I look in the mirror, you know, pick a skill, pick a mace, pick up a kettlebell, pick up learn how to do a Turkish get up, and I'll spend a whole hour on a move or perfecting the windmill or doing something like that. And for me, it's really refreshing when you've been doing what we've been doing for as long as we have. Like, to me, I've already proven I can build the most aesthetic physique. I've already proven I can increase my vertical. I can already proven I can increase my deadlift, my squat. I've done all those things. And so sometimes I don't give a shit about any of those things. And so I'll pick something that I'm not good at. Like, when you taught us the windmill, I'd never done the windmill 3 years ago. I went on a kick for like 6 months where that was like the staple move I did. Like, I just...
Yeah, I did that with bent press. It was just it was just fascinating to see where you could go with it.
Mm-hmm. Right. So I think that's a great, great piece of advice.
You know, it's funny when I hear that. For me, it's a little bit different, but I started at 14 and really, really quickly, I fell completely in love with lifting weights. I really, really did. And it quickly became something that I enjoyed doing for the sake of doing it, which is how I've been for, like I said, since I was 14 years old. So even till this day, working out for me, even if I don't get results out of it or if I don't progress, I just like doing it. I just like doing it for the sake of doing it. And I think if you can get to the place where you enjoy doing it for the sake of doing it, then you're probably going to find yourself be consistent more often than not, because you just enjoy doing it. The other thing too is that resistance training has changed for me throughout the years in terms of its utility. At some points, the utility of resistance training for me was to build muscle. Other times, it was to get leaner. At other times, it was to help me get through stress. Other times, it was for rehab. Other times, it was to help me get better for jiu-jitsu. But it's never, ever, ever left my side. I've never stopped resistance training for any really length or period of time, except for when I've had, like, I had shoulder surgery and I couldn't lift weights or whatever. That was pretty much it. I can't think of any other time. But my experience with it is just, it's very different. It's just something that, it's one of my absolute favorite things to do to this day. One of my favorite things to do is work out in a hotel gym or work out in a weird gym or work out in my garage or work out here. Like, I can find enjoyment out of those things.
Well, you've also learned, and you're really good at this, and it's something you teach on this show all the time, is you've done a really good job of connecting what resistance training does in all the other aspects of your life. Mm-hmm. And so you look at it different. And I think a lot of people struggle with this.
Yeah, if you always look at it as building muscle, getting lean, you know, getting strong, at some point you're not going to progress anymore in the gym. And then what are you going to do? Like, it's going to be totally boring. It's going to suck for you. So it's just, and you touched on this, Adam, about changing your goal. That's exactly what people need to do with resistance training or with exercise. Change their goal constantly. But then you can get to a point where you stop needing goals. And that's the ultimate, I think, stage, is when you don't need any goal anymore.
Yeah.
You just enjoy it for the sake of doing it. You know what I'm saying? Like, it would be like saying, like, what's your goal for watching a movie? Like, I don't have a goal. I just enjoy doing it. Well, that's the place you want to get with resistance training. Now, does that mean that I don't have workouts that I enjoy way more than others? Of course not. There's workouts that I fucking love, and then there's some workouts that are just like whatever, but I still enjoy it more than not doing it.
Oh yeah, I look at it as it's just good for my body. You know, and every day I just want to do things that are good for my body. And so it's like getting out in nature, like relaxing, but also I need to challenge my body. And that's what's going to keep my body resilient and healthy and moving forward. And so I just want to, I want to get stronger. I reevaluate kind of where my deficiencies will lie, and just hopping back in the weights always feels good.
One of the hardest times to work out is when you feel, when you don't feel fit or your body's not responding. This happened to me after, you know, back in the day I used those over the counter designer steroids, and I remember going off of them and your body's not producing testosterone. You go to the gym and instead of getting stronger or even maintaining, you're just getting weaker every workout. So imagine that, right? Imagine you go to the gym every day and you're training, and every day that you train, you got to go lighter and lighter and lighter.
Yeah.
You're not getting a good pump. That was really rough. Sucks. But what brought me through that period was realizing that it was better that I did it than I didn't. Mm-hmm. And also, again, put your headphones on or whatever. Get into your thoughts, get into the weights, and just enjoy it for the sake of doing it. And this is a mindset that you can adopt with a lot of different things that will get you to do a lot of different things, like chores. You could start to change your perception of what you're doing to the point where you enjoy it for the sake of doing it, and you'll find that you'll be more consistent with those types of things. But motivation is a tough one, because you're not always going to be motivated. So it's got to be beyond motivation.
Yeah.
It can't just be, you know, at some point you're not going to be motivated, and then what are you going to do?
Otherwise you're on the wagon, off the wagon. That's sort of like balance that you're always playing.
Yeah. And that, you know what, a bad workout done consistently is going to give you better results than a great workout that's done inconsistently. So consistency is probably the most important factor when it comes to being active. And with that, look, go to mindpumpfree.com. Go check out what we have that we're offering for free to our audience. So it's mindpumpfree.com. Get on there. There's about 12 guides. They're all free. You can get all of them. They cost you nothing at all. Also, you can find us all on Instagram. My Instagram page is mindpumpsal, Adam is mindpumpadam, and Justin is mindpumpjustin.
Thank you for listening to Mind Pump. If your goal is to build and shape your body, dramatically improve your health and energy, and maximize your overall performance, check out our discounted RGB Super Bundle at mindpumpmedia.com. The RGB Super Bundle includes MAPS Anabolic, MAPS Performance, and MAPS Aesthetic. 9 months of phased expert exercise programming designed by Sal, Adam, and Justin to systematically transform the way your body looks, feels, and performs. With detailed workout blueprints and over 200 videos, the RGB Super Bundle is like having Sal, Adam, and Justin as your own personal trainers, but at a fraction of the price. The RGB Super Bundle has a full 30-day money-back guarantee, and you can get it now plus other valuable free resources at mindpumpmedia.com. If you enjoy this show, please share the love by leaving us a 5-star rating and review on iTunes, and by introducing Mind Pump to your friends and family. We thank you for your support, and until next time, this is Mind Pump.